All right, hello everybody. Welcome to the November Java User Group meeting. I'm Dan. Jonathan is not here this month because he's in Belgium at DevOps drinking delicious Belgian beer and having a great time. I was there last year. It's really awesome. Hopefully go next year. So this month we're going to try to record the meeting and post it online. So Andrew's there recording it, and we're gonna see if we can get them up on our website or maybe do a podcast feed or everything else, because we get like 5 or 6 requests every month to record the video, record the meetings, and have them available. So we're gonna try that and see what the viewership is, and see just how much trouble it is, and whether or not we can keep it going. So it's an experiment, and when we post it, download it, take a look, give us your feedback. So we'd just like to go through Java news. Unfortunately, Jeff is also in Belgium and didn't send us news tips this month, so I had to go through and research it. We are just so used to Jeff sending us news that it's a whole thing. So there's a new version of Visual VM that just came out. Very exciting. Lots of bug fixes. Fresh UI, it's worth checking out if you're a Visual VM user. If you're not, you should probably try it anyway because it's a great tool. Always worth a look. Interesting announcement from Red Hat that they're working on a partnership with Zend and working on support for enterprise PHP throughout their operating system and with OpenShift. So that's kind of interesting.
Stop it. Red Hat, we get in trouble with this all the time. Red Hat's actually not camel case. It's 2 words.
It's 2 words. Well, yeah, it's camel case.
We do that internally.
There's also no registered trademark thing.
Really? That's it. You're sued.
DevOps UK has been announced. So there's now a DevOps in the spring, which is very cool and a good excuse to go to London. They haven't announced a schedule or what it's going to be, but it's going to be a 2-day event, and should be quite interesting. All the other DevOxes are very, very good, so we'll see. Oracle has posted a survey about asking what features and what's important to you in Java UE 7. So everybody should go online and fill this out if you're an UE 7 user. You can't click it here, but when you download the slides, you can click it.
It's not working.
You can cut and paste it. But it's surveymonkey.com/java-ue7. So it's a good thing to fill out because they actually do listen and they are interested in feedback. So our regular conference calendar, DevOps is on now. If you want to get a finance trip to Brazil, you can go to Java 1 Latin America. JFocus is coming up and DevOps UK. I don't know if there's any other conferences in there that miss anything. I don't know. That's the near future in Java conferences anyway. So, is there anything else exciting Java news? The release of Arai?
Did we release a version of Arai?
Anybody else hear anything interesting Java news-wise last month? I'd like to introduce Adib, and who's going to talk to us about a couple of really useful migration tools.
All right, so thanks very much for being here. I'd like to share with you today just a couple of frameworks that you can use for doing database migrations in the Java world. When you hear database migrations, you might be thinking it's going to be some sort of tool that helps you port from one data format to another. I'm sorry to disappoint you if that's what you came for. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about like how to manage a lot of SQL files for your database. So the agenda is pretty simple. I want to give you a really quick overview, just about 4 or 5 slides of the problem and the solution. Then I'm going to go through some demos with an open source framework called Flyway. and another demo with an open source framework called Liquibase. And if you want to get the code for the demos or the slides, you can just head over to Bitbucket and you can grab that Git repo there and get all of the content that you see here tonight. Just quick question for anybody here using Flyway already? Who's never heard of it before until right now? Okay, so that's pretty much everybody. Okay, anybody using Liquibase? Okay, so a few people using Liquibase. Okay, great. So this presentation is more about Flyway than it is about Liquibase, but I put Liquibase there as a contrast to how Flyway does things. So the basic goal that we're trying to solve with these data migration frameworks is, let's say you want to develop and push code into production on a regular basis. Like at my company, we're pretty much putting stuff out on a weekly basis. We're trying to get to daily basis, and I'd like us to get to continuous as soon as a commit happens. New version of the application is online. We're not there yet. In order to do that, you need to have a lot of integration tests, right? Like, you want to make sure that you didn't break something in your application. And managing integration tests ultimately is going to be, can you have a developer machine that is configured in a way that is practically identical to what you have in your production server? And tools like Flyway and Liquibase help you do that for the database configuration. So the problem that we're going to have is that when you start doing these frequent deployments into production, you don't have that luxury of doing big upfront design and get your perfect database design. You're like, I'm implementing these three features, so I'm going to create tables just that I need for those three features. And then as I implement new things and new features, I need to alter those tables, I need to add new tables. And it becomes a bit of a headache to manage these numerous .sql files that you'll end up with. And then the question becomes, how do you figure out which SQL files are on the production, which ones have been applied to test, which ones have been applied in QA, what do different developers have? And these are the situations that these frameworks for agile database development really deal with. So I'm going to click here on this little link. Actually, let's go take a look at why database migrations here. There's a really good diagrams here. So the problem visualized is something along these lines. You've got your shiny soft company, and you've got a couple of different developer machines. They've got their own local databases or schemas or whatever way you want to look at it. And you've got maybe some continuous integration server that's where you're running tests, you push from that into test, you push from that into production. And unless you have some really organized way to keep track of what's the state of each one of these databases, you might have some nasty bugs and surprises. Does anybody here have this kind of setup right now? Okay, so a couple of people, okay. So let's kind of keep going here with that. So what's the solution look like? There's a kind of two popular frameworks out there. One is called Flyway and one is called Liquibase. And my goal today is that everybody walks out and tomorrow morning you're going to be implementing one of those two frameworks, because it's ridiculously easy to use them. Like, you'll be surprised at how easy it is. I'm going to start first with Flyway. So what is it? It's an agile database migration framework. It is open source. It's inspired by Ruby on Rails migrations and how they do things there. It's very nicely documented, and it's super easy to learn. Like, I got it up and running and fully functioning in my application in about 4 hours. So I'm, 4 hours to a day is all you need to have it, active and doing stuff for you. And actually, yesterday they released a brand new version of it. So my slides are using the 1.7 version of Flyway, but now they have version 2.0. So let's start with some demos here. Okay, so let me tell you a little bit about what I've got. These demos are using Postgres as the database. How many people here use Postgres? Anybody? It's a fantastic database. It's the best database on earth, in my opinion. I am very biased towards it for some reason. I just love it. I'm going to start out here by just making sure that all of my database is in a good state. Okay, so I've cleared out my database here, and I'm going to show you what my database looks like first. We're going to consider it from the point of view of use cases, and I'm going to make these fonts a little bit bigger because I forgot to do that before the presentation. Okay, that didn't seem to do anything. So I don't know if you guys in the back can see that, but the important part is you see there's different schemas here, demo 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, and they don't have anything in them right now. So if I open up demo 1, you'll see a whole bunch of zeros. There's no tables or anything like that. Right? So the way you would start using these frameworks is what you would want is they all start by creating a table in a particular schema to keep track of what migration scripts you have executed. So I'm going to show you here just how easy it is to do something with this. So let me show you this super exciting program. I'll give you guys a minute or so, like a few seconds to read it. Sit here, count to 30 in my head. All right, so hopefully that was enough time to read this super awesome program. So as you can see here, if you weren't reading it, we have this uninteresting get data source. It's just going to basically connect to the database, so we won't look at that. We start out, we create a flyway, the flyway object. We tell it, hey, here's the data source that you're going to where the database is located. And the schema that I want you to keep track of is called demo1. And then we call flyway.init. And let's run this and see what happens. OK, so let's take a look at the console. And as you can see, there's this table that's being created with a version and a description and a type and a checksum and all this stuff. So this table is called the schema version table. You can see that here. It is a table that is created by Flyway, and it keeps track of every single SQL file that you've sent to the database using Flyway. That's the cool part about it. So we don't need to go through these details here. I'm going to run the next demo and show you what happens. Right now, if we go to back to this guy here and refresh. Oh. You can see I've got this extra table. And if I do view data on it, it's going to have just a single line here that says, hey, I've been initialized. That's all it says. Okay? Not very interesting. So let's take a look at the next example, which is demo 2. And by the way, please feel free to ask questions at any point. It makes my life easier because I'm sure it's good for everybody. It's more fun. So in this example, as you can see, I've got exactly the same program that you just saw. The only difference are these two lines here. As you can see, I'm saying now use demo 2 schema just so we can keep things separate. And I'm instead of calling init, I'm calling migrate. So what does that do? Well, there's an extra file here. If you look in my resources folder, you'll see there's a DB folder, which has a subdirectory called migration. And within that, there's a file, right? Let's take a look at this file. And what you see here is a vanilla SQL file. I mean, you can type in anything that's legal SQL for Postgres. If this was Oracle, you could type in whatever was legal SQL for Oracle or DB2 or whatever database you happen to be using. What's interesting about this file is its name. Okay? If you look at the name, I'm not quite sure how visible it is, but let me try to get it bigger. So let's as you can see from this name, it starts with the letter V. Stands for version, right? And then after the V, there's just, I'm calling it V1, right? So it's just, it can be any string that you want it to be. And then you'll notice that there's two underscores. This is kind of really important, because by convention, those files have a version, which is to the left of the double underscores, and a description, which is to the right of the double underscores. So in this example here, the version is 1, and the description is this piece right here. And the way that Flyway does things, if it sees an underscore in the name, it'll turn that into a space. Okay, so this should, when we run Flyway, when we run this demo, we should see that our database should have the user accounts and the user roles. And there should be a description, a line in our schema version table that says that the script V1 define user tables has been executed. And that should be a description of that. So now, one of the things I want you to notice is the directory that it's in. It happens to be on the SRC main resources, which is on your class path. So when Flyway starts up, by convention, it looks for any files that begin with V and end with .sql that are located on the class path in a directory db/migration. Right? So what happens when we run it? So here it is. Let's see the output of this program. Well, you can see here that it started out, and I've got it running in debug mode, so it's printing out a lot more information than you would normally. But this is good because it will help us see what's actually happening. So it started out, you can see there's a class path scanner here, and it's scanning for resources in DB migration. And you can see it tells you that the prefix is V and the suffix is .sql. Even though Flyway uses conventions over configuration, it lets you configure it should you choose to. So by default, when you create it, it has all the default configurations. Otherwise, you can change them. And then it tells you, as it does the scanning, it'll tell you where it found stuff. So you can see here that, hey, look, I found this particular .sql file. So what does it do with the stuff that it finds? Well, what it does is, it's going to, first, you can see here that it created the schema version table because it wasn't existing in this demo 2 schema. And after it created that table, it went through and you can see that it actually executed the SQL to create those tables that it found in that migration. The important part here to pay attention to is this little bit here, where it says, I started up, the current schema version was null because there wasn't a schema. There weren't any migrations, and the migrating to version 1. Anybody want to guess how it got to version 1? Why it said version 1 here?
V1.
Because the file was called V1, right? Started off with V1. That's exactly why. So that's what it did. So let's actually take a look at the database and see what's in there right now. So I'm going to close this here and go to our demo 2 and refresh that. And you can see here we've got three tables. There's a table called user accounts and user roles. These were the tables that came from the .sql file. And there's the schema version table. So let's take a look at the data that's in here. And I'm going to see if I can copy and paste this into a text file so it can be a bit higher resolution. Actually, I can just do it in Eclipse. So you can see here it's got a primary key and it's got that description. Notice that there's spaces now because it turned the underscores into spaces, so it's nice and simple. It says, hey, this was a SQL file that I executed. It says, hey, look, this is the name of the file that I used to run it. It also will say this is the checksum on the file. So this is how it detects like that the files have changed. You've also got the database user that executed that script and the timestamp when the script was executed. This number here tells you how many milliseconds it took to run the script. And then whether it was successful or not, and I forget what the last column is. Oh, it's current, which means this is the last one that it executed. Right? So that's the basic idea behind Flyway. Any questions so far?
What if we try to execute it a second time?
So the question is, what will happen if I try to run this second time? Well, let's try it out. Very good question. Demo 1 is the wrong one to run. We want to run demo 2. As you can see, it produced a lot less output this time around. And you can see that when the DB migrator ran, it says that the current version, the current schema version is version 1, and the schema is up to date. Therefore, no migration necessary.
Okay. So, but if you change the file name to version 2, it will actually run?
Yes. If you
distinguish by the file name?
So the question was, if I change the file name, will it run? The answer is yes. What it does, it tries to sort the version numbers by basically as a string sort. So if you use like V1, V2, V3, V5, it's going to get sorted correctly.
Different tags and minor versions, like 1.0.
Yeah, I've got an example of that coming up. I've got another example of that. Yes?
Managing versions or managing versions a little bit, what is the way source control manages versions? Let's say I have a SQL file that I keep updating in source control. It keeps the same name, right? So I have user accounts, I change something, I add some field, I check it in, it stays the same name. So what I would like to happen is for the file with the same name to kind of be here and just
okay.
The changes.
All right, so for the benefit of the people watching online, the question was, I've got the V1 in source control, I'm going to go and change it, and I'm going to update it. And after I update it, I want it to rerun that file and just do the changes. The answer is, that doesn't work, because it doesn't really do any kind of analysis on what's in the file. So the idea is, you basically treat the database as a sequence of changes, and you create a new file with alter statements, so you keep adding files to it. There's no limit to how many files you can have in the DB migration folder. Like for example, in my production system, I think I've got about 20 files so far. It's great because if you wanted to review the current structure of the database, you could just go and do like a dump from your database, say, show me all the DDL. If you want to see how it evolved up to that point, you can just go through these files and read them to see when was something that was added. But the way you want to really think about it is that once you've created a file and you've ran it on the production server, you should not be going back and modifying it. It just stays as is. You create all your changes as new files.
So what happens if two developers check in at version 1?
If two developers check in at version 1, well, it will maybe fail. I haven't tried that one. In my case, I'm not an expert on it. I've only been using it for about 3 months. And what the convention that we've used is that you look in source control to see if there's already a V1. And if there is, you pick like V2. And then you have to kind of rename some files before you put it onto production. I also use a trick where I actually use two directories. I have a DB migration. And in my system, I also have something that looks like this. Let me show you. I create a folder here. So I'll have Okay, so we've got a dev DB migration. So the difference between them is in my setup, I configure Flyway in the production server to only pay attention to the DB migration directory. And on a developer's machine, it will run through both of the contents of DB migration and dev DB migration. This is great because it means that while you're heavily developing a feature, you don't want that SQL committed to the production server. Is that any questions about that?
Related question.
Yeah?
Do you like to keep your DDL and SQL separate in separate files?
So the question was, do I like to keep my DDL and SQL in separate files? I'm assuming you mean like queries? I've actually done both. In my production use of it, I've got stored procedures, I've got insert statements for reference data, I've got create table statements. I tend to think about it that, like, whenever I'm implementing a feature, I want one of these little migration files that describes that feature. And so, for example, if I'm looking through the schema versions, I go, what are the tables for feature X? I can look for the file that describes feature X. So if I was building, like, for example, a blog engine, I might have a V1 define user tables because I might need users and that kind of thing. I might have another V2 define blog posts, and another one V3 define RSS feeds or whatever you happen to need. It's like you want to think of these, I think of these files as little modules. And I want to give them really descriptive names. So somebody that's looking through that schema version 5 years from now is going to be able to say, aha, how the database evolved to where it is today is obvious to me from reading the file names and descriptions. Does that answer your question? Yeah. Any, great.
Okay.
So the comment is different customers have different .sql versions. The way I would deal with that is I would do something like this. Okay, so that's supposed to be a bar, not a back. But I hope you get the idea from this example. So you would configure Flyway and you would say, look, if you're launching and you're developing for customer foo, run through the files that are in the foo folder. If you're developing for customer bar, run through the files that are in the bar folder. And one of the features that you can do with Flyway, remember like that the files were starting with a prefix, right? And the prefix by convention was V. But you could go in here and you could say, look, I'd like to set the prefix to be, I haven't set this one, so let's say if we can find it in here. Set target validation. Placeholder prefix, no. Initial version no, set initial description. Ding, 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 ding. Okay, I'm not finding it right now. I'm fairly certain it's in here somewhere. Because like it's really easy to use. I haven't been able to not get it to do what I want it to so far. So I encourage you to try that. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
No? Yeah. So that's one thing I would do with that. Okay, moving along. Let's now take a look at some pictures, because I think those are coming up. So, so demo 1 and 2 we've already done. This gives you the basic idea of it. So let's see some pictures of how SQL migrations work. So what's happened is we had this empty database here to start out with. And then when Flyway ran, it basically said, look, I'm going to start out by creating the schema version table to keep track of what's happened. And then it scanned our class path looking for migration files. And it applied those migration files to the database. So you can see in this example, for version 1, it added these tables in blue. And then in version 2, it added those extra tables in red. And you can imagine over time that what will happen with your database. And you can also use it with an existing database. So if you've already got an application in production, there's a recipe here that you can follow on their website that say, here's how you add Flyway to an existing system. You guys can read about that online. All right. Okay, we want to also take a look at the next one, the migration SQL. So if you go to their documentation, you'll see that it explains the naming scheme here with the prefix, the version, followed by the description, and the very important to have the double underscores in there. So let's see an example of that in the next version. Let me see if I put it in. No, it's not in this one. Let's try demo 3. So demo 3 is still using the demo 2 schema. And what we have here in resources now in migration, we have two files. So you're starting to see, get kind of the flavor for it. We've got a V1 and a V2, so I'm going to start out by running demo 3. And you'll see the output here. The important piece to pay attention to is, hey, the current schema was version 1, and I'm migrating to version 2. Anybody here liking this so far? This is looking good, right? I hope you're going like, this is a lot easier than writing an Ant script or a Maven, whatever, to push stuff into the database. So somebody asked me earlier about, what about the naming scheme? Are you stuck with this V2? So let me show you an example here where we're going to have a V1.1. Let's do a V2.1 first. All right. So in our V2 here, we had, say, blog post stable. And you know, it's referencing the user account, and it's got a title on a body, right? So of course, this being a blog, we go, oh crap, now we have to implement tags, right, for our blog posts. So you can go in and you can say define v2 underscore 1 underscore underscore alter blog post. You can see here we've got an alter statement to add a tag column to the table. So what's going to happen now if I run the Flyway demo again is, it has found the resources, well, these are all the ones that it found, and it figured out that the current version is 2, and it's migrating to version 2.1. Right, does that answer that question I was asked earlier? Yeah. So you can put underscores to the left of the double underscores, and it will just work. So you could have a version like version A underscore B underscore C underscore underscore, and then the description. It doesn't really care or enforce a specific convention. My attitude towards it has been that just use an ever-incrementing version number. When I started using it, I made the mistake of starting with the number 1. You should start with the number 001. It'll be a lot easier when you're looking through the directory if you get the string sorting in your IDE or on LS or whatever to see them as like 001, 002. So mine kind of look all choppy because you have all the ones, all the twos, all the threes. And I can't go back and change them because I've already put them into production. And I'm not going to go and rewrite that table history. So that's one mistake I would recommend you avoid. So that's that. And now let's try this one here now. Let's see what happens if we now go and put a v underscore 1.1, see what it does to that. Because it's kind of like in the past, right? If you look at the order of these things. So let's see what happens. This is going to give us a warning, an error. And it just completely ignored it. It says, well, it's older than the ones I've seen before, because when I sort those, it's older, so therefore I'm not going to do anything to it. So obviously, you know, by just dropping a SQL file in this DB migration folder, it's going to cause something to happen on your database. So you clearly want to be very careful about what you push into production, and you kind of do a double, triple check before you do that. Okay, comments, questions?
That's kind of like a dry run, like Liquibase is a dry run to try what's going to happen.
Does it have a dry run? I don't think so, because in the case of Liquibase, this is kind of, so the question was, is there a dry run feature? In the case of Liquibase, you write your migrations using XML, and it generates the SQL from it. So the dry run, I don't think it has a dry run feature. That's the simple answer. I've not tried it out.
One thing I encountered is the DB get kind of nervous when you try to run some tool on a production database, so they want to do like a dry run.
Right.
See what's going to happen, prove it, and then allow it to happen.
So the answer is, because you're writing SQL files, what will happen when you do a dry run is you basically go to your DBA and you say, look, these files V1, V5, 6, 7, and 8, they're going to be applied in sequence. If you want to do a dry run, you can like maybe say to them, go and run this against a test database, see what happens, satisfy yourself that they're good, and that's basically what you would do. So in a situation where you have a larger organization with well-defined roles and DBAs, you probably do not want the developers, you wouldn't want to put those SQL files in the same location as they could and just magically push them. You probably want to send them through some sort of gatekeeper, maybe isolate them into a separate project and have the DBAs be the only ones that could add files there for the production system, but for during development, developers could do whatever they want while they're building new features. So it's very flexible in how you do the process with it.
So does it make sense to like do a test against the Flyway
migrations?
Yeah.
So the question is, does it make sense to write unit tests against the Flyway migrations? The answer is, it depends. It depends because there's a feature I haven't shown you yet. Like so far I've shown you code migrations that are written in SQL, but you can also write migrations in Java code. And maybe you might want to write a unit test. I have not done that for any of mine because I just saw, okay, I just want to add a column, I want to add a table. I test them on my local development box and make sure that they work. I'm not quite sure exactly how you'd even write a unit test for something like this. So.
Can write unit tests against a test database and verify that column is added.
Oh, right. Oh, okay. I understand your question now. So you're saying, should I be writing unit tests to check that my database is exactly? The answer is yes, and we do that. Mm-hmm. So you can have your integration tests that work against the database structure, and this will work. The really cool thing about Flyway is you've noticed that when I'm launching the application, it's actually running the migrator. So the way it would work is when you run your application server, it will auto-migrate the production database at that moment. And if you're running a unit test, it will auto-migrate up to the current version when you run the unit test. Especially when you combine it with something like, it depends if you're using Spring or some other framework, but what you ideally want to do is get Flyway to be the very first thing that your application does on startup. So that all you have to do to upgrade the database in production is run it. Yes, question?
Can you have a Flyway check to see if the database is updated and fail if it's not updated instead of actually applying all the updates?
So you're saying, can I tell Flyway the database should be at version 5 and when it starts up, it's not at version 5, therefore it stops the application?
Or just to check if all the patches have been applied?
I don't know the answer to that. I know that there's a command line interface for it, which allows you to kind of like type in, you know, status, tell me the status of the database, clean the database, do a bunch of things. I haven't really played with it. The way I've been using it is strictly with when my application starts up, it just pushes stuff into the database. I don't have to think about it. I know that if it fails, it will actually stop the startup. So if you have if it detects that there's like a version 3 in here and the version 3 doesn't work, it'll roll it back. Okay? So if you're lucky enough to be using Postgres or DB2, they are actually capable of doing transactions on your DDL statements, you're golden. Like nothing bad will happen because it will do it within a transaction. If you're using Oracle when you're doing your DDL, it's gonna auto-commit on every statement, so you could end up in a bad situation where you have like 3 of the 7 statements have executed, and then you know my answer is, you know, why should you know maybe you should consider moving to Postgres. Not realistic in the real world, but you know, that's definitely a challenge there. You have to be careful, make sure it works and all that stuff.
Yeah, it sounds a little bit dangerous to have this code run at the startup of like your production environment instead of having it in a separate tool which you would run once per.
Right. So the answer is the question was, it seems dangerous to have it run on the production server startup. And that may very well be the case. And what it does have is it does have a command line utility. So you can go and type like flyway.sh and then run the command. There's Maven tasks, the Maven plugin. There is end tasks that you can do. So you can definitely have that be completely separate from your production server. You don't even need it in your class path for a production server. I find it incredibly convenient because it makes it possible for me to do continuous integration. And when Jenkins is running to build out my application, I don't have to issue any commands to set up the database. I just have to have an empty database, and it will just get populated with everything that's needed, and my unit tests can run and tell me what's working and what's not. So you have to look at it within the larger process. It's flexible to support many different ways of using it. Okay? Great questions. Thanks, everybody, so far. Anybody else? Any other comments or questions? OK, so let's go on to demo 4. And demo 4 is interesting because now you might be saying, OK, great, so I can write my I can write all my migrations in SQL, which is fantastic. I've done views, I've done stored procedures, I've done everything you can do in SQL with it. But what if I want to write Java code? You know what? I'm going from format 1 to format 2 of my application. I really need to recalculate all these complex fields, and I've already written a Java code to do that. Well, the answer is you can actually have your migrations written as a .java file. So how does that work? Well, here's how it works. You create a class. You stick that class into a package called, surprise, surprise, db.migration. And you use exactly the same naming convention. So you can see that this class has an unusually funny name for a Java class. It's not camel cased, right? So we've got v3 underscore underscore java underscore migration with Flyway. You can see that it implements the JDBC migration interface. And that gives you a method called migrate. You get given an access to the JDBC connection and go crazy, do whatever you want to do. Okay, so in here you could, I'm not doing anything because, you know, I just want to run it and show you that the method runs, but you've got a JDBC connection. Can you apply, the question is, can you apply Hibernate here? And the answer is, no, you don't want to actually. You definitely do not want to do Hibernate at this stage. Because what is Hibernate dependent on? Hibernate is dependent on your database tables. You have entities that are mapped to tables. What if you're altering one of those? Right? Because the Hibernate code that you have in the application would expect the tables to look what they're supposed to look like after the migration has run. If it's data updates. Well, you could bootstrap Hibernate here in theory, but I would highly advise you not to do that. I would highly advise you not to do that. The intention here is stick to SQL, stick to Java code. You're doing stuff before your ORM even has had a chance to boot up. If you look on the FAQ on there, it gives you more reasons as to and advice around that. Right, so let's run this, and then it's going to just print out on the console here. Run as Java application. And here is the v3 Java migration with Flyway. That was the system out in the migration code, in the Java migration class. Any questions, anybody? Yeah? So the question is, how does this v3 return to the relate to the previous ones? And the answer is, it should just continue on with whatever is the next one for that from that. So. Yeah. So when you're going for the SQL4, it should be like v4. Yeah, that's right. That's right. So far in my usage of it, I haven't had to rely at all on Java for this. I find that writing a stored procedure to do a migration is a lot more convenient than writing it with JDBC. And what's ended up happening in my application is I've got like a little API of stored procedures for doing migrations, especially when I add things that touch a lot of the existing data in the system. It can just auto-migrate to the next version. Okay, great. Any other questions?
Do you have to name the package as db.migration?
Do you have to name the package db.migration? The answer is no. You can go into the, by default, if you don't do anything, that's the place where it looks. However, when you're initializing Flyway, you can say Flyway dot set locations, and you can say like db dot migration, dev dot db dot migration, customers dot foo dot migration. Is that making sense? So you can customize that list. Yeah. Can you get it to pick up SQL that's stored in a pod?
No, I meant it's like that. Instead of doing it correctly, can it pick up its overrides from like its
pod? Oh, can it pick up its configuration from an external? The answer is yes, it can. So if you are, for example, using the Flyway Maven plugin, you would configure it with a configuration element of locations in the configuration section, and you'll give a comma-separated list of things there. Yeah. And in fact, it's quite flexible. Like the way I'm showing it to you here isn't really how you use it. Like in my case, I use Spring. So I have this configured as a Spring bean. And I just inject it with all of its settings in my Spring XML file. OK, great question. Anybody else? Any other questions before we go on to demo 5?
Can I have a mix of SQL and Java?
Yeah, it's perfect. The question is, can I have a mix of SQL and Java? And the answer is, of course you can. That's the whole idea. You know, the Java is there for complex situations. Let's say you are going to transform some blobs, all right? Let's say you had an application where you had people's photos or you had some scanned contracts and they were in a PNG format and you wanted to convert them to a JPEG format, all right? You could write code. You can't write that conversion code in SQL. You would probably want to write it in Java. Or maybe you have data that was not encrypted in the database, and now you want to do like triple DES on it or AES, and you're going to go and encrypt it, you would use Java for that. So those are examples where Java is a good fit. So it gives you the flexibility to do either way. Great question. Let's take a look at the last demo for Flyway. And this demo is actually going to show you an extension of Flyway called the test extension. And it's also going to show you an example that uses Spring in this case. Okay, so let's take a look here at how it's configured. So I'm going to start out and show you this Spring XML. All the examples I've shown you so far are all like using command line main programs, like, and you know, taking this into our app server is trivial. So I figured show it to you the easy way. So you can see here I've got the Flyway bean. I hope most of you are familiar with Spring. If you are, raise your hand. If you're not, sorry. try to follow along. You can see here I've got com.googlecode, whatever. I want to call the migrate method. I'm injecting it with the data source. I'm setting it with a list of schemas that I want it to manage. And that's basically all the rest of it. And then I've got Spring doing a component scan. So the application has a service main method here, which is just going to launch Spring. That's all it does, just from the command line, nothing really fancy. And then it goes out and says, give me some service, and I'm going to call do something on that. And let's see what happens here. We've got a service, and the Spring service is being auto-wired and injected with some repository. Right? Now, if you're using CDI, just replace that with add inject. It'll work. And you can see here that the do something method just calls the repositories get something and prints out that it's been called. So let's take a look at the some repository. It's a Spring repository. And it just prints out that it's been called. Right? So at least this way, you can see that there's a bunch of infrastructure that's happening. And you can see how Flyway kind of integrates into that. Now, why is this? So let's run the service main here. This service main, when I run as a Java application, is going to print out service.doSomething was called, and then getSomething was called, right? So we know that it's working. It's not getting null pointers or anything like that. And you can see that the first time I'm running it, it's actually doing the migrations here and applying the DB migrator here, finished migrating us to version 1 from version 0. Right? That wasn't existing before. So let's run it again, and we'll see a little bit less output this time. Okay, so this time a lot less output because it didn't actually do any SQL to the database. So next step is let's take a look at a unit test. So this is using the Flyway. And this extension only works with Spring, but I hope it gives you, if you're not a Spring user, it gives you an idea of how you could possibly integrate Flyway into your testing workflow. So in this example here, we're telling that this is a unit test with JUnit. It's going to run with the context with the Spring. So when it runs, it's automatically going to run spring.xml. And it's got two things here. It's got the dependency injection test execution listener. This is Spring speak for, hey, there's a private variable in my test with an auto wired on it. Please make sure it's correctly configured with an instance of service before any of my test methods run. And then the next one is the Flyway execution listener. And what this guy is looking for, it's looking for at Flyway annotations. So in this example here, I'm saying, look, before you run this test one method, what I would like you to do is I'd like you to clean the DB. So the invoke clean DB is a feature of Flyway that goes through the schema and basically deletes every single table, index, sequence, everything that the SQL created. Cleans it out back into a clean state without actually deleting the schema itself. So this is really fantastic for the purpose of integration tests because you want to restore your database back to a well-known state. And so what happens here, you say locations for migrate. This is an extra say, look, while you're running this method, I want you to also look in this folder here, pick up any SQL files and apply them. So let's take a look at what file is in there. So in this example, under my test, this is not good. I do not believe, there it is. There it is. Sorry. Oops. I thought I forgot where I put it. I meant to put this folder in the test resources, but I seem to have put it in the main resources. Actually, I know why I did it. I did it because the way Maven sets up the class path was causing it not to be scanned, and I didn't want to muck around with Maven's settings. So in here, you see I've got this V900 test one. What's it doing? It's a script that's inserting some test data. So let's take a look at that. Well, you typically want to have some well-known test data in your database. And that's an example of how you can use Flyway to say, not only do I want you to run the migrations for my tables, I also want you to insert some test data. And here's the directory that has the test data in it. Who's liking that? Anybody liking that? OK. Any questions about that? So let's take a look at the test so you can see, actually, I want to prove to you that it's actually working. So what I've done is I'm going through here with the test one. And I'm creating a JDBC template. This is just a way in Spring to quickly do a select statement. I'm going a select count star on the user account. You saw that I had a single insert, right? So if this method here, when it does the select, it should see one row in the database, right? So let's see if this actually runs. Yay, it's all green. So that actually proves to you that there was some data in the database. But the really cool part is, let's go look at the database now to see if it has any test data in it. So this is, I believe it was demo 5. Yeah. Oh, it does have a row in it. Oops. OK, I found this project yesterday, and I haven't played around with it enough. So egg on my face right now. I expected this to be clean, but it's not. It's got that row of data in there. OK, I don't know why in all my previous attempts it was deleting it, but right now it's not. That's the danger of live demos. Right, so that's that idea of how to integrate it into your system. Any questions or comments so far about Flyway?
Do you need to connect it with transactions?
Well, you could if you did have these add transactional methods. Yes, it would do that. If you had it configured to roll them back, yes. It will respect that. Yeah.
And for the Java classes when you migrate something, are they also transactional? Or if they, no exception, will the
Okay. So the question is, if we go back to this guy right here, if this throws an exception, will it roll it back? You know what? Let's try it out. The answer is yes, it will. So let's just throw new runtime exception. Hello there. This won't work. All right, and I'm going to go and like kind of reset my database so it will rerun that migration. This will blow away all my test databases. And it will get stuck because I have a hold on those. So I'll quit that program and do it again. Okay, much better. So let's go to demo 4. Well, we need to run demo 3 first because of how I set up these files. And I've got to roll that out of here because that's the 1.1. Yeah, I'll just delete this. All right, so it's that worked now, and I can go to demo 4. Aha, we got an exception, which is exactly what we want. You can see here that it was trying to migrate to version 3, and there was an exception. Migration to version 3 failed. Changes successfully rolled back. Because the migration is happening within the context of a transaction. So if your migration code in there with the connection, it was just doing inserts, updates, deletes, that's all happening within one transaction, and you won't have any problems with rolling it back. This is another, this brings up a good point. Because some databases don't have they don't have transactions on DDL, if you have inserts, updates, and deletes, you may want to put those in a separate SQL file from the one that's actually modifying the tables. So that way, if the DDL fails, it will, the inserts and the updates and deletes never run. Of course, you should all, you know, I'm taking it as a given that you're backing up your database, and if the migration failed, you would not be in big trouble, and that you probably tested it thoroughly on some copy of your production database before you actually tried it on the production one. So I'm assuming you're doing all those things. Okay, great. So any other comments or questions about Flyway? Okay, so some highlights for Flyway. I think it's simple, easy to use. Who's convinced of that right now? I've showed you everything you need to know about it. It has automatic migration on startup, as you saw. It does use convention over configuration, so you put things in db.migration, the file naming convention. It lets you write migrations in simple SQL. You can write Java migrations. It is cluster safe. What does that mean? What happens if you have a cluster and you have two machines that are launching up at the same time? They're going to connect to the database. They're both going to try to migrate. The answer is, whichever one of them gets a lock on the schema version table will win, and it will be the one that does the migration. Okay? So it's safe to have 5 machines in a race condition starting up trying to migrate with the same scripts. It does have Maven and Ant support. It will fail quickly and if it can. It has a schema clean feature, quite useful for running integration tests. And it does have some command line tools that I did not show you. All right. So you guys ready to look at Liquibase now? Right. So what's Liquibase? It's another agile database migration framework. It is much older than Flyway. And it is also nicely documented, but it does use XML for capturing changes. So I only have one demo on that. I don't use Liquibase, so that's why I have the cheat sheet here with the Maven commands to remember exactly, so my demo will work. But I think it's very valuable to understand the difference between these two tools, and hopefully after this presentation you can kind of figure it out for yourself which way you want to go. So Flyway, let's take a look at Liquibase demo. So with Liquibase, you have this file called a changelog. I kind of just copy and pasted this from their quick start guide. And you can see that you have these things called change sets. They have an ID and an author. And the combination of the ID and the author gives you uniqueness. So Bob can have ID 1 and Jim can have ID 1. And it'll say Jim and Bob are two separate migrations. You can see that it's saying, hey, create me a table. Table name is department. Add a column to it with the word ID, type int, with the primary key constraint. Add a name, varchar 50. So it's not SQL that you're writing. You're writing XML. What's the advantage of this? The advantage is Liquibase can read this XML file and say, you want to install these changes into Oracle? I'll do the right thing for Oracle. Oh, you want to do this into MySQL? I'll do the right thing for MySQL. Oh, DB2 is different. I'll do the right thing for DB2. So it has the ability to translate the SQL into this XML to and from the different databases. So if I was building an application where I had to support 5 different databases, I might very well consider Liquibase a better solution than Flyway. There's nothing that stops you from using both of them at the same time. It would be kind of really annoying. You have 2 schema versions, be kind of hairy, but who knows. So that's the basic idea. So let's go here and see how to invoke it. So it doesn't have, it has a, you can call it from an API the way I called Flyway, but I'm not familiar with it, so I'm going to stick with the Maven plugin that it has and demo that. So let's see, what do I have to do here? And I think I type MVN Liquibase update. Yes, there we go. MVN Liquibase update. Here we go. So you can see it found this changelog XML file. And number of changes to apply is 0. Why did it do that? I don't know. Okay, my demo fails. Okay. It did actually work. There we go. It did successfully run Bob with ID 1, ran successfully in 8 milliseconds. I think there's probably ways to get this to print out the SQL that it generated from that. I just don't know how to do it with Liquibase. But I wanted you to have an alternative to Flyway. And the cool thing that it does that Flyway does not do is this has the ability to roll back. So right now, this table is in the database. And if we go, we'll see it there. But I will just, in the interest of time, since I've been talking for a bit longer than I expected, I'm going to type, that's what I need to type. So I'm going to type MVN-D. Liquibase dot rollback count equals to 1. Sorry? Yes, thank you. And we're going to do Liquibase rollback. Wrong spelling of bad typing here. And you can see here it actually rolled it back. If I was to show you the database, you'll see that the tables was created, then it was dropped. Because you have these SQL create table, like description of the structure that you're using, it can create the SQL for creating, moving forward and moving back. Right? So Flyway does not support that. If you look on their FAQ page, they'll explain to you why they believe that that is not a very useful feature to have. And that's my presentation. Questions, comments? Sorry, can Liquibase do, what do you mean?
Insert statements.
Okay, so the question is, can Liquibase do insert statements? The Liquibase can do in .sql file anything that is legal for that database. So there's no difference between what you type in a migration SQL file and what you type in the command console for that server. You can do inserts, update, deletes. I've done inserts, I've done updates, I've done deletes, I've done create view, I've done create stored procedures, I've invoked stored procedures. I think I misunderstood you. Oops. Okay. This will be recorded forever now. No, Liquibase does not let you type SQL. Sorry. Liquibase, you're stuck with the XML. I don't know the answer to that. But what I can point you to is that there is a giant matrix of features on this site here. If we go to the homepage for Flyway, which kind of goes through and says, this is what Flyway can do, and this is what some of the alternative frameworks can or cannot do. So I highly recommend you at least you pay attention to that. There's some really good comparisons online with different people kind of saying, here's what we do, here's why we chose one over the other. In my case, I chose Flyway because I'm only working with Postgres. It's an application that's hosted as a service. But if you want to try out my application, you can go to venturelinks.com, links like the cat, L-Y-N-X. And that's in production right now, and it's using Flyway. I don't care about the, I really wanted the flexibility of writing .sql files. Didn't want to deal with the XML, so. Hey, great, any other questions?
There's no flexibility added by writing XML, actually.
Sorry, is there any flexibility? Look, if I was selling a product and my customers were like, I want it running on SQL Server and I want it running on Oracle and they're paying me a lot of money for it, then I would say probably there is. And I think if I remember vaguely reading when I was researching this stuff that Liquibase has some Grails or some other way of not having to use SQL, not having to use XML, I mean. So, you know, both I think are good established products and you know, pick your poison, decide what you like best, and use it. Yeah, go ahead.
One feature of Liquibase I found particularly useful, it can synchronize databases. So let's say you have continuous integration server,
yeah,
and you bootstrap it, let's say, from Hibernate. Whether it's good or not, separate stuff, right? You bootstrap it from the Hibernate, and then you can say to Liquibase, please synchronize continuous integration database with the test database, and it figures out the difference between the tables, and it can generate alter statements automatically. You can review them, and you can execute them on test database, so it kind of lets you flow the
okay, that's pretty cool.
Continues to test from test to production while reviewing them.
Okay, so just want to summarize for the people on the internet, the comment from one of the Liquibase users is that Liquibase has the ability to analyze two versions of the same database that are in, like, say, pointed at Postgres A, pointed at Postgres B. It can analyze what's different between A and B, generate alter statements, and make them look the same. That's pretty neat. Yeah, you guys will have to decide which one you want to use. Okay, any other questions, comments? All right, well, I think that's it then. Thank you very much for coming out and listening to me speak about this. I hope it was useful to you, and you'll try this out in your project.